Good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Hindi News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 24th November 2019. Today's Hindi News Analysis is going to be a lengthy one as we have included one more session in today's analysis, that is comments and clarification session. In this session, clarification will be provided for the comments that was posted by our viewers based on their doubts. We hope this session will provide more clarity to our viewers regarding the content we provide. Now, these are the list of articles chosen for today's analysis. It has been provided along with the page numbers of Chennai, Bengaluru, Delhi, Thiruvananthapuram and Hyderabad editions. The link for the handwritten notes and the timestamping for the displayed articles is provided in the description box below. And for the benefit of smartphone users, the timestamping is also provided in the comment section. Let's move on to our analysis. Today's first discussion is based on this FAQ article, which talks about various laws that were enacted to deal with illegal immigrants. The article refers to the illegal immigrants as the illegal non-citizens. The syllabus that can be linked to this discussion is given here for your reference. Now, before entering into the news article, you should know that citizenship, extradition, admission into India, and immigration and expulsion from India, then passports and visas, all these subjects come under the union list in Schedule 7 of Indian Constitution. Now, this news article mentions some important features of legal frameworks that were put in place to deal with the illegal immigrants. These legal frameworks are, first, the Foreigners Act of 1864, then the Passport Entry into Act of 1920, then the Foreigners Act of 1946, then the Foreigners Tribunals Order of 1964, then the Illegal Immigrants Determination by Tribunals Act of 1983. Now, the author discusses these legislations in the backdrop of recent announcement made by the Union Home Minister. Recently, our Union Home Minister has announced that an NRC exercise will be conducted throughout India and the process will be repeated in the state of Assam also. So now let us see the first legislation in modern India on illegal immigrants to India. This law is called as the Foreigners Act of 1864. This act provided for the expulsion of foreigners, that is, the removal of illegal immigrants. It also provided for their arrest. It also provided for the detention when their removal is pending. It also provided for a ban on their entry into India after their removal from India. According to a judgment made by the Allahabad High Court in 1960, this 1864 Act was later replaced by the Foreigners Act of 1946. Now let us see the next legislation that deals with the illegal immigrants. This law is the Passport Entry into India Act of 1920. This legislation is still in force in addition to the Passports Act of 1967. This 1920 legislation mainly requires that any person who enters India must have a valid passport. And this 1967 Act provides for the issue of passports and travel documents to Indian citizens. And this act also regulates the departure of Indian citizens from India. Then the Passports Entry into India Act of 1920 also empowered the then British India government to make rules so that the person entering India must possess passports. This act also granted the government the power to remove. That is, if a person arrives in India without a valid passport, then this person can be removed from India by the government. That is, this person can be expelled from India. Next, we will see about the Foreigners Act of 1940. This legislation is called as a wartime legislation. This is because this law was enacted by the Imperial Legislative Assembly during the Second World War. This 1940 Act introduced the concept of burden of proof. This is mentioned under Section 7 of this Act. It states that whenever there is a question on the nationality of a person, then the onus or the responsibility to prove that he or she was not a foreigner lies on that person itself. So, if the person could not prove that he is not a foreigner, then he will become an illegal immigrant. Now, in this context, author talks about when the Foreigners Act was made more stringent. Now, this was done in 1946. This legislation is called as the Foreigners Act of 1946. This act repealed the 1940 Foreigners Act, and this 1946 Act gave wide powers to the government to deal with all foreigners. And also know that This is the law that is applicable for foreigners at present. Now, this 1946 Act defines foreigner. According to this act, a foreigner is any person who is not a citizen of India. The act also empowered the government to make provisions for three things. One is the government can prohibit the entry of foreigners into India. Second, the government has the power to regulate the entry of foreigners in India. And third, it also gave the government to put needed restrictions on the entry of foreigners into India. Then the act also restricted the rights enjoyed by foreigners during their stay in the country. For example, if you see Section 7 of this act, it states that the information related to the lodging or sleeping accommodation shall be open to inspection by any police officer at all times. So like this, there are some restrictions to the rights that is enjoyed by the foreigners during their stay in the country. Now, some restrictions will be based on the orders that are passed by the appropriate authorities under the Act. Then the 1946 Act also empowered the government to secure compliance of the Act. The Act empowered the government to take necessary steps for ensuring compliance. These steps also include the use of force if required. Now, this is based on Section 11 of this Act. Now, the most important provision of this Act is the concept of burden of proof. According to this Act, the burden of proof lies with the person and not with the government authorities. This provision was upheld by the Constitution Bench of the Supreme Court. So, what is this Constitutional Bench? This is based on Article 145, Clause 3 of Indian Constitution. This article states that there should be a minimum number of 5 judges to sit for the purpose of deciding any case that involves a substantial question of law which requires interpretation of the Constitution. Such a minimum number of 5 judges shall sit also for the purpose of hearing any reference under Article 143 from the President of India. Now, this Article 143 deals with the power of President to consult the Supreme Court. So, the benches which are constituted under Article 145 Clause 3 are called as the Constitutional Benches. Now, coming back to the burden of proof under the Foreigners Act of 1946. Now, based on this provision, there are several concerns over the recent announcement made by the Union Home Minister that there will be a nationwide NRC. So, if a person could not prove that they are Indian citizens from a particular cutoff date, then their names will be left from the National Register of Citizens. So, during the nationwide NRC exercise, it may be said that it is the individual who has to prove that he is not a foreigner. Now, in addition to these provisions, the 1946 Act also enabled the government to make orders to deal with foreigners. So, in this context, let us now talk about the Foreigners Tribunal's Order of 1964. This order is presently in force, but before this order, there were some orders which were made under Section 3 of the Foreigners Act of 1946. Under this order, foreigners' tribunals can be constituted to determine whether a person is foreigner or not. This tribunal has the authority to decide whether a person is a foreigner within the ambit of the Foreigners Act of 1946. Now, this tribunal has powers which are similar to those of a civil court. Before passing an order, this tribunal gives reasonable opportunity to the person who was alleged to be a foreigner so that the person can produce evidence in support of his case. The cases are referred to the Foreigners Tribunal by the central government or by the registering authority under the citizenship rules. Now, in June 2019, the Union Home Ministry has made an amendment in this Foreigners Tribunal's Order of 1964. This amendment empowers the district magistrates in all states and union territories to set up foreigners' tribunal. Now, after this, the news article also talks about an important legislation which was enacted to handle the foreigners' issue in Assam. This act is called as the Illegal Migrants Determination by Tribunals Act of 1983. This act was introduced for the detection and deportation of illegal migrants who had entered India on or after March 25th, 1971. Now, know that this law is presently not in force. This is because of a petition filed by the present Chief Minister of Assam in the Supreme Court. According to the news article, the present Chief Minister of Assam has challenged this law in the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court has struck down this law in 2005 while hearing the petition. It was struck down by the Supreme Court because this law was not effective in identifying and deporting the illegal immigrants. Now, you should note that this act was made applicable for whole of India, but it came into force only in Assam. The Supreme Court found that since the enforcement of this act in Assam, that is since 15th October 1983 till June 30, 2001, only 1,494 illegal migrants had been deported from Assam. But on the other hand, if you look at West Bengal, where Foreigners Act was enforced, around 4.89 lakh Bangladeshi nationals had been deported between 1983 and November 1998. And also, Supreme Court closed all the tribunals in Assam which were functioning under this Illegal Migrants Determination by Tribunals Act of 1983. Supreme Court transferred all pending cases of these tribunals to the Foreigners Tribunals, which were constituted under the Foreigners Tribunals Order of 1964. So now you may have a question that why this act was ineffective. That is why the Illegal Migrants Determination by Tribunals Act of 1983 was ineffective. This is because of one reason. This act did not have any provision on burden of proof similar to the Foreigners Act of 1946. So as a result, the burden was laid on the authorities to establish whether a person is an illegal migrant or not. Now in this context, there are two things. One is that when even a government authority is finding it very difficult to prove a person as foreigner, then how difficult it will be for an alleged person to prove by himself when his case is genuine. Now, this is because a lot of government documents will be required to prove that a person is an Indian citizen since a particular cutoff date. If a person has not saved those required government documents for a period of, say, since independence, it will be difficult for them to prove. Now, this could happen if a person's legal literacy is less, or if the person or a child has no legal guardian, or if the person has become old but has no personal attender. Then for such person, even though they are Indian citizens, they may not be able to prove that they are Indian citizens. These concerns will arise when a nationwide NRC will be carried out. Then the second thing is that the provision of burden of proof on authorities became failure in Assam. But this may not be the case with rest of India. Now this is the opinion of the author. So here you should just know that in both circumstances, there are benefits and some disadvantages associated with the concept of burden of proof. Here under circumstances, we mean in one case, the burden of proof is on the government to prove a person as illegal immigrant. And in the other case, the onus is on the alleged individual to prove whether he or she is an illegal immigrant or an Indian citizen. So that is all about this FAQ article. In this discussion of FAQ article, we saw about various legislations that were enacted pertaining to foreigners. Then we finally discussed about the concept of burden of proof and how it may play when a nationwide NRC will be implemented. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. The displayed practice question will be discussed in the last session. This discussion is based on the revoking of President's rule in the state of Maharashtra. The syllabus that can be linked to this discussion is given here for your reference. This discussion based on this news article is about the recent twists and turns in the Maharashtra politics. In order to understand this article, we need to know the recent developments in Maharashtra. The Maharashtra Legislative Assembly elections were held in October 2019. Now, in this assembly elections, a two-party alliance had won an absolute majority in the polls. But things did not go well between the pre-poll allies because both parties demanded the seat of chief minister. And hence, even after weeks, a government was not formed in the state of Maharashtra. Hence, the governor gave time for the top three leading parties of the state to prove their majority in the legislative assembly. But all these three parties failed to prove their majority. So, governor recommended for president's rule in the state. Based on his recommendation, president's rule was imposed in the state under Article 356 of our constitution. So, what is this Article 356? This article comes under Part 18 of our Indian constitution, which deals with emergency provisions. This Article 356 empowers our president to issue a proclamation if he is satisfied that a situation has arisen in which the government of a state cannot be carried on in accordance with the provisions of the constitution. Now, president can issue a proclamation either based on a report of the governor of the state or even otherwise also. Like in our case, president has proclaimed emergency in the state based on the report of the governor. So after imposing president's rule, there are two options. Firstly, after the imposition of president's rule, if there is a possibility for the parties to come together to form a government, then a government may be formed in the state. And meanwhile, the president's rule can be revoked from the state. Now, the second case is that if no parties come together, then president's rule continue in the state till the situation becomes conducive for the election commission to conduct fresh assembly elections. Now, in the present case, what happened was two parties have claimed that they have the support of MLAs to form the government. So consequently, president's rule was revoked and new government, which claimed support of MLAs, has sworn in yesterday in the state of Maharashtra. So now, with this brief background in mind, let us look into the news article. According to the news article, the center revoked the proclamation of president's rule in Maharashtra by using Rule 12 of the Government of India Transactions of Business Rules 1961. Now, these 1961 rules were framed by the President of India using his powers under Article 77, Clause 3 of Indian Constitution. According to this clause, the President shall make rules for the more convenient transaction of business of the Government of India. And under this same clause, President can also allocate the same business among the ministers. So based on this clause only, this Government of India Transactions of Business Rules 1961 was framed. Now, under these rules, Rule 12 is of importance today because under this rule only, the center has revoked the proclamation of president's rule in Maharashtra, according to the news article. So, what is this Rule 12? This Rule 12 is about departure from rules. See, normally when we say departure, it also means deviation. So, this Rule 12 provides a provision for deviation from the rules that are mentioned under this 1961 rules. This Rule 12 states that the Prime Minister may in any case permit or condone a departure from these rules to the extent he deems necessary. So, when Prime Minister thinks it is necessary to allow for a departure from these rules, he can do so based on this Rule 12. Or even he can approve such departure from these rules. So, when can this Rule 12 can be invoked? According to the government sources, this rule can be invoked to meet a situation of extreme urgency or unforeseen contingency in any particular case. But the sources also mention that in such situations also, the process of examination and interministerial consultation would need to be followed. It further states all cases under Rule 12 are mandatorily required to be routed through the Cabinet Secretary and should in no case be sent directly to the Prime Minister. But there is no clarity on what could be the extreme urgency or unforeseen contingency. Now, you may think how based on these rules, President's rule has been revoked. See, usually the cabinet, which is led by our Prime Minister, takes the decision to revoke President's rule. And then the cabinet conveys it to the President. Now, in our case, the cabinet did not meet to revoke the President's rule because the center used its powers under Rule 12 of Government of India Transaction of Business Rules of 1961. But if you see, when the president's rule was imposed in the state, it was imposed after the approval of cabinet that was headed by the Prime Minister. So now also the ideal case would have been the cabinet taking the decision to revoke the president's rule. If you even see the 1961 rules, under Schedule 2 of these rules, there is a list of activities or cases which has to be brought before the cabinet. And under these cases, it is mentioned that cases relating to a proclamation of emergency under Articles 352 to 360 of the Constitution and other matters related thereto. So this means whatever decision is related to the proclamation of emergency under Article 352 to Article 360, it has to be brought before the cabinet based on these rules. Even though these rules have this second schedule and that second schedule provides for this provision, our center has invoked Rule 12, which provides for deviation from these rules. So that is the deviation which we are talking about. So what happened after center took this decision? Following this decision to revoke president's rule, our president revoked the proclamation under Article 356, Clause 2 of our Constitution, which mentions that any such proclamation may be revoked or varied by a subsequent proclamation. So it can be revoked by a subsequent proclamation. If you see the news article, it mentions that the president's rule was revoked in the early morning of 23rd November. So this shows that the decision was taken in haste, that is, in a hurry. So for time being, what the center has done appears lawful. But as we know, India is a parliamentary democracy which favors a collective decision making rather than individual decision making. So revoking the president's rule through a cabinet decision would have been the ideal move. So the legality of the actions of the government will be challenged in the Supreme Court. So let us wait for the decision of the Supreme Court and how the court interprets these rules. So that is all about this news article. With this, we have come to the end of this discussion. The displayed practice question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next discussion, which is based on Industrial Security Annex and other foundational agreements of US with its defense partners. The syllabus that can be linked to this discussion is given here for your reference. The news article talks about the recent and expected future developments in the India-US relationship. According to the news article, the next 2+2 dialogue between India and the US is likely to be held in the US Capitol in December 2019. Now, the first 2+2 dialogue between India and US was held last year in September 2018. So, what is this 2+2 dialogue? The 2+2 dialogue is held between Indian External Affairs and Defense Ministers and their counterparts. The dialogue is aimed to provide a positive, forward-looking vision for the India-US strategic partnership. Now, the news article mentions that during this next 2+2 dialogue, both the countries, that is India and US, are expected to sign the Industrial Security Annex, or in short, ISA. News article also adds that this ISA is an add-on to the General Security of Military Information Agreement, or in short, GSOMIA. See, India and US signed this GSOMIA in 2002. Actually, US enters into 4 foundational agreements with its defense partners. And one among them is GSOMIA. And it is also the first such agreement between India and US. Now, this GSOMIA enables the sharing of military intelligence between the two countries, and it requires each country to protect others' classified information. So it is said that the Industrial Security Annex will add to this existing agreement on protection of classified military information. And this ISA is critical for any transfer of technology by a US firm to its Indian partners. It means if this ISA is signed, then it will enable transfer of key high-end technology from US defense firms to Indian firms. So this will make the state-of-the-art defense technology available to the Indian defense firms. We know that state-of-the-art means the most recent and updated technology. Hence, this ISA will give a boost to the Indian private sector, which is looking for a greater role in the defense manufacturing. Now, we saw that US enters into 4 foundational agreements. Now, the second foundational agreement, which was signed between US and India, is the Logistics Exchange Memorandum of Agreement, or in short, LEMOA. Now, this LEMOA is an India-specific version of the Logistics Support Agreement, that is LSA, which the US has with many other countries. This LEMOA was signed between India and US in 2016. Now, this agreement gives access to both countries' designated military facilities on either side, and it is for the purpose of refueling and replenishment. Now, under this agreement, both the countries can avail access to each other's military facilities for various logistical supports during port calls or during joint military exercises, and they can do military training and then disaster relief operations, then humanitarian operations, etc. All these are facilitated by this LEMOA agreement. Then the third foundational agreement, which is signed between US and India, is the COMCASA, that is Communications Compatibility and Security Agreement. Now, this agreement was signed in September 2018 on the sidelines of first 2+2 dialogue. Now, the news article states that in the upcoming 2+2 dialogue in December, the various steps that were taken to operationalize this COMCASA will be reviewed. Now remember that this COMCASA is an India-specific version of the Communication and Information on Security Memorandum of Agreement, which the US has with other countries. This agreement is in short known as CISMOA, that is CISMOA. This agreement is valid for a period of 10 years. This COMCASA allows India to procure and transfer specialized equipments for encrypted communications. It is meant to facilitate the use of high-end secured communication equipment that is to be installed on military platforms, and it will help to receive modern, secure and net-enabled weapon systems such as precision armament, air-to-air missiles, space systems and navigation systems that are critical components in the platforms like fighter aircrafts and unmanned aerial system. According to the news article, the most significant development of this COMCASA is the Centrix kits. Centrix is the acronym for Combined Enterprise Regional Information Exchange System. This Centrix facilitates encrypted communications between the navies of India and the US. So this was about the third agreement, COMCASA. Now the fourth agreement is BECA, that is Basic Exchange and Cooperation Agreement for Geospatial Cooperation. Now this agreement is not yet signed between India and US. Now if this agreement is signed, then BECA will allow India and US to share geospatial and satellite data such as topographical data, nautical data and aeronautical data with each other. Now this agreement is not yet been signed because India and US have differences over the issue of reciprocity in the exchange of geospatial information. That is, both the countries have differences over the issue of mutual exchange of information with respect to geospatial information. So it is said that both sides are trying to resolve the issues, and hence BECA is unlikely to be signed in the upcoming 2+2 dialogue. So we can conclude by saying that India and US defense ties are improving over the period. We can hope that in the near future, BECA will also be signed. So that is all about this news article. The respective practice question will be discussed in the last session. Now this last news article is based on FAQ, which is about consumer expenditure survey. Now the Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation had decided not to release the results of this survey. This survey was conducted by the National Statistical Office during 2017 to 2018. Now due to time constraint and also because we have very recently discussed about this survey, we are not going to discuss it today. To know about the survey and why it was not released and the reasons behind it, we request the viewers to visit our 16th November news analysis. The link for the same is also given in the description box and also in the comment section. Kindly view that analysis and based on this, try to attempt this practice question. With this, we have come to the end of news article discussion session. Now we have come to the special session of our day, which is based on comments and clarification. Let us move on to the comments discussion. These two comments are based on SPG protection. First comment says, why only the Prime Minister is covered under SPG protection? Why not the President? Who gives security cover to the President? On that day, we clearly discussed about the special protection group. See, according to some sources, the group was established after the assassination of Prime Minister Indira Gandhi by her bodyguards in October 1984. Subsequently, this group was established in 1985. So at that time, there was no legislation, but later an act was enacted by the Parliament. This act is the Special Protection Group Act of 1988. So at that time, the Special Protection Group provided protection only to the Prime Ministers. But after the assassination of former Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi in the year 1991, the protection was extended to former Prime Ministers and their family also. And this was done by amending the Special Protection Group Act of 1988 in the year 1991. Now, why President is not included? Because with respect to President, the protection of President is the primary role of President's bodyguard. This President's bodyguard is an elite household cavalry regiment, and it is the senior most regiment of Indian Army. So as the name implies, the primary role of President's bodyguard is to escort and protect the President of India. This regiment was first raised in 1773 during the British occupation. It is also the regiment that is carrying out ceremonial duties for the President of India. So the personnel of President's bodyguard are excellent horsemen, capable tankmen, and they are paratroopers. So that is why the president is not covered under the protection of SPG. Now, this next comment is by our regular viewer. This comment was based on an editorial about the traditional medicine system in India. This comment was based on the discussion which was on an editorial about the traditional medicine system in India, then the challenges in integrating it with the modern medicine system, and the efforts put by the government for the promotion of Indian traditional medicine system. So in our analysis, we have explained many initiatives by the government in this direction, but we failed to mention the traditional knowledge digital library. So the viewer should be appreciated for bringing this to our notice, and we request other viewers to include this initiative of the government also. So what is this traditional knowledge digital library? It is an initiative of the government of India which helps in safeguarding and promoting the traditional medicine system in India. Now this traditional knowledge digital library, or in short TKDL, is a collaborative project between the Council of Scientific and Industrial Research, which is under Ministry of Science and Technology, and between the Department of Ayurveda, Yoga and Naturopathy, Yunani, Siddha and Homeopathy, that is Department of Ayush, which is under the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. This TKDL involves documentation of the knowledge that is available in public domain on traditional knowledge from the existing literature that is related to Ayurveda, Yunani and Siddha. This documentation is done in digitized format. It provides digitized data on traditional medicines in 5 international languages. These languages are English, French, German, Spanish and Japanese. So what is the objective of TKDL? It has been estimated that thousands of wrong patents concerning Indian systems of medicine were being granted every year at international level. Now, the reason for this was the fact that India's traditional medicinal knowledge exists only in local languages such as Sanskrit, Hindi, Tamil, Urdu, and also in Arabic, etc. So, it was neither accessible nor understandable for the patent examiners at the international patent offices. That is why the digitized data on traditional medicines is provided in 5 international languages, namely English, French, German, Spanish and Japanese. Now, this TKDL initiative of our government has inspired many countries. So, several countries and organizations such as South Africa, African Regional Intellectual Property Organization, then Mongolia, then Nigeria, Thailand and Malaysia have shown interest for creating their own TKDL based on the TKDL that was created by India for protecting its own traditional knowledge. So this is the information which you should know about traditional knowledge digital library of Government of India. Now in this next comment, our viewer has asked, what is the difference between rule of origin and yarn forward rule? See, rule of origin is a set of rules that mandates the declaration of source of a particular good. So we can say that rule of origin is related to the source. Now this rule of origin is a part of major agreements and it prevents the misuse of tariffs since the countries of the world do not follow uniform tariffs. Now we are going to take the same example which we discussed during on that day also. Consider 3 countries, one India, then Myanmar and then China. Now imagine the tariff for importing a good A into India from China is 20%. And the same good A, if it is imported from Myanmar, then the tariff is 10%. Then also assume that the tariff for importing good A into Myanmar from China is 5%. So that means if this good A is directly exported by China to India, then the tariff will be 20%. But if the same good is routed through Myanmar, then the tariff will be 15% only, because from China to Myanmar it is 5%, then Myanmar to India it is 10%, so totally it will be 15% only. So there is every possibility that China will take advantage of this provision and it will dump goods into India. Now this can be avoided if rule of origin is mentioned. To a larger extent, the routing of goods can be prevented because the source country will be compulsorily mentioned on the good. Actually, this rule of origin applies for majority of the goods. However, there are certain rules which are specific to certain sectors. Now, one of them is the yarn forward rule, which the viewer has queried about. There is actually no difference between the rule of origin and yarn forward rule. We can say rule of origin is a major set and yarn forward rule applies to one of the sectors, which is a subset of this major set. If you see the literal meaning of yarn, it means a spun thread that is used for knitting, weaving or sewing, like the one you can see in this picture. So from this we can easily say that the yarn forward rule applies to the textiles and apparel sector. Now sometimes this rule is also mentioned as yarn forward rule of origin. So what does this actually mean? It means that all products in a garment from the yarn stage forward must be made in one of the countries that is party to any of the agreements, such as the agreements like North American Free Trade Agreement, that is NAFTA, or Central America Free Trade Agreements, or Trans-Pacific Partnership, or even the proposed RCEP, etc. For example, imagine the Central America Free Trade Agreement. Now, under this agreement, the yarn forward rule states that the yarn, the fabric, sewing thread, and the final garment itself must be made in a region which is present either in the United States or in one of the six Caribbean or Central American countries that is party to this agreement. In simple terms, we can say that the yarn forward rule means the benefits of the agreement is to be received by the regional producers under the agreement rather than the outside players such as China. Now in this next comment, our viewer has asked what this statement actually means. Supreme Court is supreme but not infallible. Now the viewer has highlighted the statement made by Mr. Asaduddin Owaisi with respect to the recent Ayodhya verdict. Now, Mr. Owaisi is presently the member of Lok Sabha from the Hyderabad constituency in Telangana. Our viewer has asked the meaning of the statement made by the member of parliament. According to the statement, the Supreme Court is the highest court of appeal in India and it is also supreme and final. So now why we are saying Supreme Court as supreme and final? One reason is that it is the highest court of appeal in India. Secondly, as per Article 141 of Indian Constitution, the law, that is the judgment declared by the Supreme Court, shall be binding on all courts within the territory of India. And thirdly, the Supreme Court is the final arbiter over the questions related to the provisions of Indian Constitution. Now, in exercise of this authority, the Supreme Court can strike down any law made by the Parliament if the law violates the Indian Constitution. But even the Supreme Court also at times commits some errors or mistakes. That is, it is fallible. Fallible refers to the tendency to commit errors or mistakes. The words of the Supreme Court itself is a testimony to this statement. At one instance, the Supreme Court itself admitted that in some case laws, it has wrongly sentenced some persons to death penalty. So the Supreme Court is supreme and final, but not infallible. That means it is fallible, which means Supreme Court is also prone to commit some errors or mistakes. Now this next comment is with respect to a question in our 6th November in the news analysis. The viewer has asked why that statement is wrong. Mortality is first and morbidity is second. Is this the reason? Awaiting for reply. Now the viewer has commented this with reference to the third statement in this practice question, which states acute respiratory infection is the second largest cause of morbidity and mortality in 2018 among communicable diseases. Now, if you look at these images are from the National Health Profile 2019. This is released by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. This first image deals with the percentage distribution of morbidity that is reported in communicable diseases in the year 2018. As per this data, the acute respiratory infection is the largest cause of morbidity in 2018 among the communicable diseases. So, it should not be the second largest cause for morbidity. Now, in this, morbidity refers to having a disease or a symptom of disease or simply the state of being infected. On the other hand, mortality refers to death of a human being because of a particular disease. But the statement in the question reads as the second largest cause. So this is a wrong statement. That is why the statement 3 becomes a wrong statement. Now if you come to the second part of this third statement, it states that acute respiratory infection is the second largest cause of mortality among communicable diseases in 2018. This statement is correct because As you can see in this data, pneumonia is the largest cause of death among communicable diseases in 2018, and it is followed by acute respiratory infection. So this means acute respiratory infection is the second largest cause of mortality. Now, since the first half of the statement is wrong, the entire statement becomes wrong. And that is why the correct answer to this question was option C, all except 2 and 3. Now, if you look at this next comment, this comment is with reference to our discussion on 3rd November 2019 on the Media Certification and Monitoring Committees in the Election Commission. See, the Election Commission has constituted these committees based on the order of Supreme Court on 13th April 2004. This verdict is pronounced in the case law of the Secretary, Ministry of Information and Broadcasting versus Gemini TV Private Limited and others. These committees give pre-certification to the election-related material that are to be projected on the electronic media. Government sources do not mention pre-certification for ads in print media. So, pre-certification by Media Certification and Monitoring Committees is only for ads in electronic media. The next important task is monitoring. Here, print media is included. These committees monitor both print and electronic media. This is to monitor whether any publication or broadcast of material are violative of the model code of conduct or whether it is violative of any election laws, etc. Now, the question of the viewer is that whether these committees perform their task also for print media. Now, with respect to the pre-certification, the scope of MCMC is for election-related material that are to be projected on the electronic media and not print media. But for monitoring purposes, the scope includes newspapers and any other type of print media also. Now, you have to note that the scope includes ads for paid news in bulk SMS or voice messages, TV channels or KB network, or in radio or FM channels, then in cinema halls, in audio video displays in public places, and also in social media along with print media. Now, if you want more information related to this Media Certification and Monitoring Committee, kindly visit our analysis on political advertising in social media on the November 3rd, 2019 Hindu News Analysis. Now, in this comment, viewer has asked to explain western disturbances. See, western disturbances are the western cyclonic disturbances. These cyclonic disturbances enter the Indian subcontinent from the west and from the northwest during the winter months. Therefore, during winter months, the weather of the north and northwestern regions of India are usually influenced by the western disturbances. They give the highly needed winter rains over the plains and also cause snowfall in the mountain. These winter rains, which are brought by the western disturbances, are locally known as Mahavat. These rainfalls are of immense importance for the cultivation of rabi crops in northwestern India. So, where do these cyclonic disturbances originate? They originate over the Mediterranean Sea. Since these disturbances originate in a region which is west to India, and since they enter India from the western side, they are called as western disturbances. In other words, we can say that disturbances from the west. Now, we should know who brings these cyclonic disturbances into India. They are brought into India by the westerly jet stream. These jet streams are located approximately over the 27 degree to 30 degree north latitude, and therefore they are called as subtropical westerly jet streams. These jet streams are a narrow belt of high altitude westerly winds in the troposphere. Now, in this high altitude refers to an altitude of around 12 kilometers from the earth's surface. And these winds are called as westerly as they blow from the west. Now, in this comment, our viewer has asked a doubt with respect to CSIR, that is the Council of Scientific and Industrial Research. Viewer has asked that CSIR is an autonomous body, but it is under Ministry of Science and Tech, which is headed by Prime Minister also. Then on what basis it is considered as autonomous? Now, to understand it, you should know what are autonomous bodies. Autonomous bodies are set up whenever it is felt that certain functions need to be discharged outside the governmental setup. And these autonomous bodies are given some amount of independence and flexibility without day-to-day interference of the governmental machinery. These autonomous bodies are set up by the ministries or departments that are concerned with the subject matter, and they are funded through grants in aid. They are funded either fully or partially, and this depends on the extent to which the institutes generate internal resources of their own. These grants are regulated by the Ministry of Finance through their instructions, as well as the instructions relating to powers for creation of posts, etc. These autonomous bodies are mostly registered as societies under the Societies Registration Act, and in even certain cases they have been set up as a statutory institutions under the provisions provided by various acts. Now, with respect to CSIR, you should know that in the year 1940, that is during Imperial India, the Board of Scientific and Industrial Research was constituted to facilitate industrial research. After this, in the year 1942, this BSIR was made into CSIR, that is Council of Scientific and Industrial Research, and it was registered as an autonomous body under the Societies Registration Act. And remember that CSIR is funded by the Ministry of Science and Technology. So that is how it is an autonomous body, and also it comes under a ministry, and hence it is headed by the Prime Minister. In this question, the viewer has asked which of the states are affected by stubble burning in Punjab and Haryana. See, we know that the cool months of December and January are best known for producing thick fogs and aerosol hazes in the northern India. And stubble burning is one of the major contributing factor for air pollution in North India. But one more contributing factor for air pollution is the unique geography. It is because air masses get hemmed in or trapped by the Himalayan mountains in the north and also by the Vindhya mountains in the south. So when the temperature inversions occur, all the smoke, dust and industrial pollution that are entering the atmosphere ends up piling over the Indo-Gangetic plain because it cannot get over the mountains. Now, in this temperature inversion is nothing but the reversal of the normal behavior of temperature in the troposphere. Now, in this, a layer of warmer air lies over the layer of cool air at the surface. This process will trap the aerosols, and it results in more air pollution in the area. Now, along with the unique geography, the wind flow patterns also play a major role in deciding which of the states are affected by the stubble burning. So based on news, you can say that the frequently affected states are Delhi, Uttar Pradesh and also Bihar to some extent. So that was all about the comments and clarification session. The remaining comments and the clarification based on them will be provided in some other video. Now let us move on to our last session for the day, that is the practice question discussion session. Now this first question is based on President's rule. The first statement states, Article 356 empowers the President to impose President's rule in a state if the state fails to give effect to a direction given by the center. Now to answer this question, you should know the provisions which are with respect to the President's rule. Now first know that Article 355 imposes a duty on the center to ensure that the government of every state is carried on in accordance with the provisions of the Constitution. Now, based on this duty only, the center takes over the government of a state under Article 356 when there is a failure of constitutional machinery in the state. Now, this is popularly known as President's rule. So, on what grounds President's rule can be proclaimed? It can be proclaimed under Article 356 on two grounds. One ground is mentioned in Article 356 itself, and another is mentioned in Article 365. Now, Article 356 empowers the President to issue a proclamation if he is satisfied that a situation has arisen in which the government of a state cannot be carried on in accordance with the provisions of the Constitution. Now, this decision of the President is based on a report of the governor of a state or even otherwise also. That is, even without the governor's report. So that means the second statement is wrong, because it states as per Article 356, President can proclaim President's rule in a state only after report given by the governor. Now, Article 365 says that whenever a state fails to comply with or fails to give effect to any direction from the center, then it will be lawful for the President to hold that a situation has arisen in which the government of the state cannot be carried on in accordance with the provisions of the Constitution. So this makes statement 1 as the wrong statement, because it states under provisions of Article 56, but rather it is under the provisions of Article 365. Now here question asks for the correct statement. Here neither first statement is correct nor second statement is correct. So the correct answer is neither one nor two. Now this next question is based on the agreement signed between India and USA. Now read this question carefully. The question asks, which of the following agreements is not signed between India and USA? Now this is a very straightforward question. The correct answer is option D, Basic Exchange and Cooperation Agreement for Geospatial Cooperation. That is in short, BECCA. Now this first agreement was signed in 2002, the second was signed in 2016, and the third was signed in 2018. Now let us wait and see when this last agreement will be signed between India and USA. Now this next question is based on All India Household Consumer Expenditure Survey. Now the first statement states, the survey collects information on the consumption spending patterns of households across the country. Now remember that traditionally this survey is a quinquennial survey, that is, it is conducted every 5 years by the National Sample Survey Office, that is designed to collect information on the consumption spending patterns of households across the country. So this statement is correct. Now this survey covers both urban households and also rural households. So this makes statement second as correct. Now the third statement states, the survey is conducted every year by the National Sample Survey Office, which is an integral part of Central Statistics Office of the Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation. Now you have to be careful by attempting this statement, because very recently, that is after May 2019, the statistics wing of Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation was restructured. So based on this restructuring, the Central Statistical Office and the National Sample Survey Office are integral part of National Statistical Office, which is under the Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation. So NSSO is not an integral part of CSO, rather these both offices are integral part of NSO, that is National Statistical Office. So the correct answer to this question is option B, 1 and 2. Now let us see one mains question based on GS paper 2. The question states, with reference to the recent proposal by the Union Home Ministry to carry out NRC exercise across India, discuss various concerns that require attention prior to implementing the proposed action to identify the illegal immigrants. So we have to just list the various concerns that require attention before implementing the NRC exercise across India. So you can mention one or two lines about this NRC exercise, and you can also mention about illegal immigrants. Then with respect to concerns, you can say first concern is with respect to the cutoff date to determine the illegal immigrants, because we know that in case of Assam NRC update, the cutoff date was fixed as 24th March 1971. But under Article 6 of Indian Constitution, July 19, 1948 is the cutoff date for migration to India from Pakistan. Whereas Nagaland has kept 1st December 1963 as cutoff date in its efforts to compile a register of indigenous inhabitants of Nagaland. So a clarity is required from the government with respect to cutoff dates before beginning a nationwide NRC, because based on this cutoff date only, individuals will be differentiated whether they are illegal immigrant or they are citizen of India. Now the second concern is with respect to the onus to prove that the individual is an Indian citizen, and this onus lies with whom. Firstly, it has to be clarified whether it lies with the government or individuals. So if it is government, then the process should be made effective by learning the lessons from the challenges faced by the tribunals, that is established under the Illegal Migrants Determinants by Tribunals Act of 1983. Then if the onus is on the individuals, then appropriate assisting mechanisms has to be set up to help the persons having low level legal literacy, to help the illiterates, and to help the older persons, and to help the persons in old age homes, then to help refugees, then children without capable guardian, then also to help the orphaned children, etc. Then the third concern is that what will happen to those whose names will be left out in the NRC process. Now this thing has to be addressed even before the exercise begins. It should be clearly mentioned whether those whose names are missed out will be deported or not, or what will happen if the country from which the person came from does not agree that the person belonged to it, or will these persons will be given a refugee status, or will they be given a short-term work permit, or will they be held in detention facility. etc. All these things require clarity. Now, the fourth concern could be whether there will be any discrimination among the illegal migrants in terms of religion. Now, this has to be definitely clarified because this concern is raised in the light of amendments proposed under the Citizenship Amendment Bill of 2016 and 2019. Now, in this bill, it was said that persons belonging to minority religious communities from Pakistan, Bangladesh and Afghanistan are not to be treated as illegal migrants. Now, this also requires a clarification from the government before the beginning of the exercise so that the NRC exercise may be held efficiently. With this, we have come to the end of today's Hindu News Analysis. If you like the video, don't forget to like, comment and share. And do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates related to civil service examination preparation.